Welcome to this special edition of our AppDev Summit series. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead for the AppDev practice at theCUBE Research. And we're here to dive deep into trends, tools, and technologies that are shaping modern application development. From theCUBE's AppDev Summit, we've seen a powerful convergence of platform simplicity, developer productivity, as well as AI acceleration and DevSecOps first thinking. I'm joined by Vish today. Vish, how you doing?
Great. How are you, Paul?
Good, Vish. Hey, you want to introduce yourself to the audience?
Yeah, so my name is Vish Abrams. I'm the chief architect at Heroku, which is a subsidiary of Salesforce.
Thanks, Vish. It's great to have you here. You know, when we talk about Heroku, it's really a platform as a service that continues to empower developers to streamline that path from idea to production, right? And when we're looking at the AppDev Summit overall, we see that it incorporated everything from day zero to day one, as well as DevSecOps. So when we're looking at the efficiencies and day zero, all the way to exploring observability and cloud economics through day two, Heroku really has that vantage point across the whole application lifecycle. So Vish, when we're looking at, you know, unpacking how Heroku can, you know, adapt to helping stage the new era of security, scalability, and AI-infused software development, how is Heroku, you know, from a day zero perspective, it's been known as a developer-friendly abstraction layer for the infrastructure, right? It's been, in the context of day zero focus, the simplicity of operational efficiencies, and Heroku has really been continuing to reduce that cognitive overhead for a lot of developers, while enabling them to scale with confidence. What are your thoughts around how Heroku can really impact day zero?
I think one of the most interesting bits of Heroku from the beginning, the approach to how you actually deploy your first bit of software on Heroku, which is essentially just to git push, it means that you can remove all of that cognitive overhead about getting started. And Heroku is built in a way that it supports whatever language that you already work in, whatever framework you're using, whatever stack you use to manage your dependencies, it can handle all of those things. So if you're a Python developer using pip or UV, no problem. If you're using Go, if you're using Ruby, in any language that you're used to building in, the same way that you build something locally, you write your code, you do git push, and then it gets up and running. So I think shortening that the cycle time on the first deploy is really important for those day zero operations. And it's one place that Heroku has always excelled.
It definitely has. I mean, I think that when you look at it from a production and developer productivity, looking at day zero for the build cycle, it's incredibly important to have a platform that allows you to deliver what you need to deliver. But also we have to think about DevSecOps, right? DevSecOps is becoming table stakes. And when we think about Heroku and the CI/CD pipeline, the approach for ensuring software supply chain integrity and continuous compliance for developers, it really is a big part of the platform. How does that help with day one, when you look at driving the release of these new products, depending on whatever code you're using or whatever language you're using, how does that help with the delivery?
Well, I think the primary way that it helps is sort of streamlining or making it seamless to go from, say, an individual developer working on their laptop in through staging, production, and all the different environments to the point where you have a whole team of people working on a single code base. And we do that through things like integration with source control providers like GitHub, and then having features like our review apps feature, which allows a developer working on a team to take a branch of the code and push that to the branch, and then automatically a review app comes up that shows the difference between your original application and the new application for the team to review. And a lot of teams actually embed that into their software development delivery and review process, where part of the process is pushing the code, getting the review app, having a human go in and look at the differences and make sure that this app is actually doing what we want it to do. And then the next stage is to have it just promote through the pipeline. So there's no manual process after the human level review. So you get the humans where they need to be and you get the automation where it needs to be. And that's how you make day one and day two much, much more efficient.
Oh, I agree. I think that that's really the key elements that you kind of touched on. But I when I think about it, I also want to double click down a little bit on the DevSecOps piece, right? I think DevSecOps kind of applies across the entire CI/CD pipeline. So if we have DevSecOps, you know, as kind of a I'll call it a table stakes to the CI/CD pipeline, what Can we talk a little bit about how Heroku really helps drive that, you know, the security elements of the CI/CD pipeline?
Yeah, I think one of the most important pieces is consistent build processes, right? So that you have using our cloud native Buildpacks, which is something that Heroku pioneered along with Pivotal many years ago, that were built off the original Heroku Buildpacks. The entire principle of that process is that you have a consistent way for your software to be built. If you look at something like using Docker files, which is the sort of the de facto way that this is done, if you don't have a consistent process, you end up with what I call security vulnerability proliferation, because you have every team building their own Docker file, defining how their application dependencies are pulled in, what's installed, et cetera. And those things very quickly go out of date. And when you fix it in one place, you then have to go fix it in every place. If you centralize the build process through a consistent mechanism using something like Buildpacks, then all of those concerns happen in one place in the system. And Heroku has a process which we refer to as rebasing, where we can actually swap out the underlying kind of operating system underneath the container. So you could think of it as the base layers of the container automatically for you, so that you just have to worry about your source code, and then it pulls in updates if there's a security vulnerability automatically as you go through the life cycle of your application on Heroku.
I can totally see how that makes a lot of sense, especially when we think about some of the new regulations that are going into play. I mean, with things that are relevant to developers today, when we talk about whether it's executive orders for securing an SBOM or looking at the new EU CRA requirements that are going into play, having a platform that allows for that control and understanding of a compliance regulations and governance really helps developers reach their potential and their goal, but at a faster pace. And doing it yourself is an option. It certainly is, but the devils are in the details. And I think that's really where a lot of the challenges come into play without understanding this. Vish, I want to switch over to cloud cost and application efficiency here, right? During the CUBE's AppDev Summit day two research, we emphasized observability and cloud spend and performance tuning. And that's a big part of how we look at day two when we think about the operational side of it. And we think about how Heroku is driving and helping organizations balance developer velocity with cost-efficient observability deployments. What does that mean from Heroku's perspective, from a day zero perspective?
So I think there are a lot of different ways that you can manage your cost controls in the system. I mean, the first and obvious thing that you need is some sort of mechanism to determine sort of how utilized your system is. Heroku actually has built-in metrics for things like CPU utilization, RAM utilization, so you can see how your applications are performing over time, and that sort of naturally comes as part of the dashboard. And then for certain language, we actually have an extra level of instrumentation around, for example, if you're in Java, then you can enable application metrics that'll tell you things like the JVM heap size and usage in that aspect. Having all of those sort of come automatically out of the box is really helpful. And then for more advanced use cases, we support things like being able to export OpenTelemetry tooling out of our system and out of your application directly to kind of get to that next level of custom metrics to be able to handle those things. And then, of course, once you've determined your usage and utilization of things, then we provide really easy tools to scale your application up and down. For example, you can just scale out your dynos. Dynos are what we call our running containers to match the application load or even react dynamically to application load over time.
Yeah, so Vish, I mean, this is very clear that if organizations are using open source standards like OTel, for example, Heroku can accommodate those standards as well into that platform itself. I think that's a big factor that needs to be taken into consideration, because maybe organizations, depending on where they are in their journey, if they're early on their journey and they're trying different things, is there an opportunity here for organizations to kind of move from what they're currently doing and their bespoke solution to Heroku? And how difficult is that moving that platform from one approach to another?
I think it really depends on how many of the existing sort of open standards you're already using. So we've had a bunch of customers going from on-prem workloads or other cloud providers that are more low level into a Heroku managed environment. And if you're building your application, if you have built your application in a way that follows what we've always referred to as the 12 factor principles, which are how to build scalable applications from scratch. So if you're kind of following that structure for your applications, then the move over to something like Heroku is very, very easy because your application is already structured in a way that sort of naturally fits this stateless model that Heroku provides. If your application is built more old school, then there's probably some migration costs that you're going to have to pay. And that really depends on, you know, being able to modernize your application as you move it onto a more sort of cloud native system like Heroku.
Yeah, I like that. I like that answer. I talking about bridging the gap between old and new. I like to talk about, you know, that in the practice, of course, when you're talking about app dev, there is always the past, present, future states. And what we saw throughout the App Dev Summit was the, you know, AI enhanced developer tooling was growing. It's a growing theme across the entire summit. And so talking about AI, and I know we're this far into the presentation or the discussion here, we finally brought up AI, but I think it's important to kind of understand that, you know, how is Heroku enabling or planning for AI native applications development or AI assisted, agents for developer workflows on its platform?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of different ways. I think we need to divide AI into two categories. One is using AI to write the code that ends up running on Heroku, and one is using AI agents and tooling inside your Heroku applications. For the second bucket of using AI tooling inside your applications, we actually just recently released Managed Inference and Agents, which allows you to connect to LLMs and sort of natively build some very powerful tools using things like LangChain and Python or some of the existing open source technologies. You can connect it right up with very minimal setup and actually enable some AI capabilities in your applications. For the first bucket of using AI to help write code that's deployed on Heroku, we're taking a little bit more of a broad open source approach with that one. We've been, as I may have mentioned before, if you've seen, we've been updating the 12-factor app manifesto. And one of the ways that we're thinking of tweaking that is if you look at the 12-factor app manifesto, when it was created, it was written for people to be better at building applications that are scalable. It came at a time when a lot of new developers were coming into the field using things like Ruby on Rails and needed that guidance of how to build web applications. And now agents need that same guidance. So the approach that we're taking is how do we actually put the right rules in place so that AI agents that are helping write the code are building applications in a 12-factor way from the beginning, instead of having it build something and then you have to go retrofit the sort of scalability concerns and the management concerns. I think as an industry, we've learned a lot over the past dozen or so years about how to build these things properly. And some of that is embedded in the large language models and they're doing it naturally, but some of the principles maybe haven't been fully learned because they're being pulled, the information is being pulled from, you know, small example apps or testing things that aren't really considering what it takes to build a full distributed application and scale it.
Yeah, absolutely. And when we look at these multi-platform or polyglots kind of strategies that are out there, it really is, I think, where Heroku really positions itself as where it shines in the modern applications development stack, because this is really what you're trying to get to. Even though Heroku's been around for a long time, you've evolved to really adopt that Kubernetes dominated kind of narrative that's out there in the world. And we saw that throughout the CUBE, you know, App Dev Summit. We saw the research that was kind of highlighting the fact that organizations are moving towards these cloud native or Kubernetes native approaches and such. What are your thoughts here about the evolution of the App Dev stack? I mean, we talk about that in the context of AI, of course, but what does that mean overall, just in general, for, you know, guidance for the audience?
Yeah, I think, I think highlighting the power of Kubernetes is definitely important. When Heroku was originally built, we had our own orchestration layer because it predated Docker and Kubernetes and mostly predated containerization as a whole. As the years have gone by, the open source projects have gotten more and more powerful, things like Kubernetes, things like OpenTelemetry. And so what we've done is started replatforming all of our internal systems onto these tools. I think one of the dragons inside of the Kubernetes ecosystem is the complexity with which it is, the deep level of understanding you need to actually use it effectively can be a big hurdle for a lot of customers. In fact, I had a conversation with one customer that had moved all of their internal stuff onto Kubernetes, and he said, "My problem is we've got a Kubernetes cluster that's working, it's great, but my best developer spends all his time just managing that cluster. I would love for him to be able to work on business problems, and he can't because he's managing the Kubernetes cluster." And they are very powerful, but they require a lot of effort to manage and use correctly. And so using something like Heroku, which can kind of be an intermediary where we're using the same technologies underneath but we're providing you a much easier interface so that your developers can just focus on building the business applications, I think is a really nice nice middle ground there. So you get the value of the underlying software without having to pay the cost of managing it.
Vish, always been great talking with you on this. You know, I think that one thing I want to, we're coming to a close here, but one thing I wanted to do is give you the final word here. Organizations are in various stages, right? They're either early in their stage or very mature. They don't know sometimes how to even get started. What should the organizations do to, you know, to think about Heroku? Is there a kind of a trial? How do you get going on this? Also, like, what would you advise them on, like, how to become more educated on the platform?
Yeah, so getting started is super easy. At this point, you do have to sign up with a credit card. It does an authorization. Just we've introduced that to avoid a large amount of fraud that was coming to the system. But it's very minimal setup. You put your credit card in. The basic plan is only $5 a month, and you can just try it out, experiment with it. And we have a bunch of great getting started guides in whatever language. You can find them on the Heroku website that'll just walk you through getting your first app up in a matter of minutes. It's a great way to get started and experiment.
Awesome, Vish. Well, thank you very much for your insights on this topic. And the AppDev Summit overall has been really great. The research is really powerful. It really aligns to what Heroku's value proposition is. It's really powerful. I think it's awesome that we had the opportunity to have this discussion. And I want to thank the audience for watching here and those of you that tuned in. We appreciate you being part of the AppDev Summit. It's been really a great session, a great summit. Lots of data, lots of research. We want to continue the conversation. But that wraps up this summit series, this episode here. But we'll be on another series, another episode to watch. So make sure you tune into the entire series of the AppDev Summit and we dive into things like the tools, the trends, the talent that shape the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge or building AI or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. So be sure to follow us on social if you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect. You can reach me at paulnn@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.